the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome each of you, and I am glad to be back myself. I thank you for your prayers in my absence and in my time of sickness. I've got a little lingering brain fog, so if you see me fade out today, it's just part of the aftermath, okay? I want to welcome members, newcomers, friends here at Celebration, those who are with us through Facebook Live, as well as those who are here in person. Wherever you are today, welcome and thank you for being part of our worshiping community of faith. If you need a community to belong to, if you're thirsty for the word of life and you want to be a disciple of Jesus, then we invite you to join with us in his ministry and mission. Know this, you are welcome and you are needed here at Celebration Presbyterian Church. Now join me for our responsive call to worship. Called by God, we have come to worship.
Called by Christ, we have come to follow.
Called by the Spirit, we have come to rejoice.
Called together, we will listen and pray and worship God.
Please bow with me for prayer. Holy God, we gather to sing your praise and hear your word. Speak to us now that we may be wise enough to perceive your call. Strengthen us now that we may be brave enough to answer when you call. Guide us now that we may follow and serve you where you would have us go. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand and tap your toe and sing along. You're going to like this, so get ready. Hymn number 700, I'm going to live so God can use me. Good morning, Elijah. How are you, sir? What can you tell me about the game Follow the Leader? Help me out.
That you have to listen to the person that is telling you what to do.
That person would be the leader, right? They're going to tell everybody else. And so if you were the leader, you would tell me and I would follow your instructions. Right? Well, it's funny that we find that same story in the Bible when Jesus begins calling disciples. They were working, doing their regular jobs. Today we're going to read about fishermen that were fishing. And yet in the midst of their fishing, Jesus called them to stop what they were doing, drop their nets, and to come follow him. So he's the leader and he says, follow me. What you going to do if you're the one following instructions? Fade out? Okay. You're going to get up and follow him, right? If he says, follow me. He also said, I'll make you fishers of men and women. So he was going to teach them how to do a different kind of fishing. So as disciples, all of us are disciples. Jesus is our leader, right? So if we want to know what we're supposed to be doing, we have to read our Bible, listen to the things Jesus says, and then try our best to follow him, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Let's say a little prayer together. Gracious God, thank you that Jesus has come among us as God in the flesh to help us better see you and know you and understand you and follow you. So he says to us, come follow me. Help us to do just that, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, buddy, just do it, okay? Announcements. We're going to have a brief session meeting today right after worship. Tables are already set for us there. Next Sunday morning following worship, we will have our annual congregational meeting. At the close of worship, we will share a review of last year, 2021, and present the approved 2022 budget to the congregation. And the congregation will be asked to vote on proposed changes to the terms of call for the pastor for this year, 2022. The session has approved these recommended changes and now brings them to you, the congregation, in this meeting following worship next week for your vote. All members are eligible to participate and vote. Tuesday evening virtual Vespers, good Lord willing, and we have the voice to do it, Tuesdays at 7:30. Choir rehearsals, Wednesdays at 6 p.m. We're still collecting food either here in our receptacles in the hallway or throughout the week in the big cargo box out in our parking lot. This goes to help our neighbors in need here in Horry County. You did a tremendous job last year. Keep up the good work, okay? If you have prayer concerns throughout the week and can share those with Irma in the church office, she will not only include them in the list that goes out early in the week to our prayer chain members, but she and I will make sure to include them in our list going forward for Sunday. All right. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But the good news is, if we confess our sins, Jesus has promised to be faithful, not only to hear our confession, but to forgive our sins and to cleanse us of our unrighteousness. So let's join together and confess our sins collectively and then personally during a few moments of silence. Master, we have worked all day and night for many months and years. We yearn for a heavy catch, a full church, an abundant feast. Forgive us, God, when we're too tired to cast our nets one time, when we're too stubborn to do things a little differently. Have mercy on us when we are too afraid to dive into deep waters and take a risk. Grant us grace that we may proclaim your word, work for your kingdom, and trust your promises. Amen. Friends, hear the good news and believe it. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. How good of God. And thanks be to God. One of the things we do each week as we come together is say what we believe. This week we'll use the Apostles' Creed, one of our historic creeds in the Christian church. Let's say what we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you have a joy or concern to share, if you'll write that on a prayer card and bring it to me, we'll include that as we name off those joys and concerns. And while you're at it, if you'll find your friendship pad on your row of chairs and sign in and share with others on your row of seats.
Thank you, Kira.
And if you do have prayer concerns, there are cards in the top of those little portfolios. Help yourself. As we prepare for this, and you can take this time to fill out a prayer card if you need to, we're going to sing the first two verses of hymn number 761. You may remain seated, called as partners in Christ's service. Before we get into sharing joys and concerns, here comes one. This prayer request is for relationship help with mom and me getting along, for her to get saved, and maybe even holding on to, not holding on to grudges. Thank you. This is a prayer request from the Thornburgs for a neighbor, Bill Thorpe. He's got pneumonia, and he's also battling prostate cancer. Also from the Thornburgs, their longtime friend, Michael Clayton, who suffered cardiac arrest and is now in a coma. Cindy Smith asked prayers for her husband, Glenn. He's having an extensive back surgery on Tuesday of this week. Will that be at Grand Strand?
Waccamaw.
Okay. And Carol Legacy says prayers for a dear friend, Susan Darbyshire, who was diagnosed this week with aggressive and terminal blood cancer. We want to remember Terry Pettijohn. He is home and recovering from his recent back surgery. We lift up Lillian Stilgis under the care for poor kidney function. We remember Ashlyn Burrows for her safety and wellness and protection. We lift up Mike Kelly, brother of Carrie Kelly, who's battling stage 4 cancer. We lift up Brian Ward, cousin of Terry Baker, who has pancreatic cancer. Peggy O'Neill asks prayers for a friend's son who's dealing with multiple personality disorder. He's recently released from jail and in therapy. We want to remember his whole family as they go through this together. We lift up Carol Lagasse's former son-in-law, Troy Mudgett. He too is battling stage 4 cancer, and we lift up his wife and his son, Jake, also. Please remember Jimmy McDowell. He is at Grand Strand where he has contracted COVID. We pray for Irma Stackhouse and the extended family of her son, Patrick. He died of stage 4 cancer at the end of last month. But we want to remember all of his loved ones who are still in the process of grief. Sharon Peters is caring for her husband, Lee Peters. He too is recovering from recent surgeries, and they sent their thanks for all your prayers throughout this time. Hunter Scott, 32-year-old, who is dealing with recovery from Guillain-Barré syndrome down at the Shepherd Center in Atlanta, is making progress. The doctor says it will be slow, but thank God for progress. We lift up Stan Carpenter, Cecilia Evans' brother-in-law, and are thankful for the progress he's making. We lift up our veterans and pray for shelter and wellness and support. We also lift up Mike Stakem, friend of the Kellys. He has finished his radiation and chemotherapy for cancer in his tonsils and lymph nodes, and now he's just dealing with side effects from the treatment. We lift up our brother Jesse Wallace and pray his continued relief and healing from shingles. We lift up Jeff Walsh and pray for efficacy in this latest round of cancer treatment, and for healing and help for his son Davis's health issues. We lift up Mary Lou Strom, who has renal failure. We lift up Lois Crone as she's adjusting to her new home at Portside Retirement Community. We pray for Robert and Rita Callender's son in California, his sister in Florida, his nephew in England, Darren Hofert, who's also battling stage 4 cancer. And we lift up Darren's wife, Alex, and son, Mason. We also pray for Robert as he's in New York trying to help his brother, Hugo Jones, relocate to a new nursing care facility. We lift up all who are battling COVID-19 and all who are still awaiting vaccination, those healthcare workers and first responders who are still on the front lines treating the sick. We pray for Lauren Hancock for strength and emotional healing. We lift up Patty Youngblood for her health and wellness. We pray for Ron Plummer's niece, Casey, for her ongoing recovery and for her family's ongoing support. We lift up Kathy Harms for her overall healing and wellness. We lift up my cousin Madeline Tillis for continued progress in her recovery from a fall and traumatic brain injury. We lift up our congregation for our ongoing mission and ministry. And we pray for our preschool staff, students, and parents for their health and wellness and safety. Please bow with me now for prayer. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of life, for the gift of your Son, and for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Lead us through the trials, the suffering and sorrow, the challenges and struggles, the tired times and dark places. Be with those who weep or cannot sleep, who have no peace, and who are seeking release. Lead us with grace, with love, and with peace. Fill us with hope, with patience, with stamina for answering your call, for pushing out to deeper waters, for fishing and fishing and fishing some more, trusting the catch to you. Transform us in your image and in your Son and in your name. Transform us to grow, to understand, and to see you with greater clarity. Transform us so that we may be made whole. And in wholeness, may we willingly and joyfully be the hands and heart of Christ for the world today. Bless each friend and family member and joy and concern that we have named this day. And be with us all to help heal and to help and encourage and guide us as we seek to faithfully answer Jesus and to follow his call in the way. Generous God, continue to grow our congregation with deepening devotion to prayer, commitment to servant leadership and service, and increasing depths of our own generosity as we work together with you to advance your mission and ministry in this community and throughout your world. God, we believe that you are guiding us into your bright future for celebration, one blessed day at a time. And we thank you that you came down to be with us, that we may have life and love and joy. These prayers and hopes we offer to you in confidence and gratitude, O God, for your love and your presence with us. Hear us now as we pray together as Jesus taught his first disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us join in singing the last two verses of Called as Partners in Christ's Service.
Thus new patterns for Christ's mission in a small or global sense. Help us bear each other's burdens, breaking down each wall of fence. Words of comfort, words of vision, words of
as we come to the time of receiving and giving our tithes and offerings, there are several ways to give. For those of you here in the sanctuary, we have a plastic receptacle on the table at the entrance. For those of you at home watching through Facebook live stream, you can mail a check to the church office or drop it by during the weekday hours of the church office, or go through your online banking and direct it this way. Or use the church website, which offers a donate now and a recurring payment option. However you choose to give, you have chosen to give generously and continuously, and we appreciate that. So God bless you. Now hear this invitation. Whom should God send? Who will go for God's people? Here we are. God is counting on us. So let us share our gifts and our offerings in answer to God's call. Help us, Lord, we pray, to serve you with gladness and with generosity.
You still
please stand as you're able, and let's join in singing the doxology with Alleluias.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Bow with me for the prayer of dedication. Increase the strength of these gifts and the strength of our ministries, O God. Expand the nets of our love that we may reach deeply and share abundantly in loving generosity through the mission of our church. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Our scripture lessons today are two, and the first comes from Psalms number 71, verses 1 to 6, and our gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. So let's prepare our hearts and minds to hear and receive God's word with just a few moments of silence, followed by the prayer for illumination. O God, who is closer than breath itself, and yet cannot be contained by time and space, reveal your life-giving truth that comforts and disturbs us through Jesus the Christ. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Friends, listen, hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church. First from Psalm 71, verses 1 to 6. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and the cruel. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. Then from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, Jesus saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Jesus got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then Jesus sat down and he taught the crowds from the boat. When Jesus had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and they filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, He fell down at Jesus' knees saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on you will be catching people." And when they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This is God's word for God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Well, I titled this, Calling All Sinners. Today in Luke's gospel, we hear a powerful call story. Jesus, the son of a carpenter, teaches Simon Peter and his seasoned fishing companions to fish in ways that go beyond their wildest imagination or life experience up to this point in their lives. Jesus interrupted their work of cleaning the nets. Jesus had already asked, and Simon had obliged, to push the boat out from the shore in order that he could use the boat as a pulpit from which to teach that eager crowd that had gathered around him along the shore that day. And now, after a long night's work with little to show for their fishing efforts, Jesus tells Simon, "Push out a little further into the deep waters and throw these cleaned nets back into the sea once more." I wonder what ran through Simon's head. What does this carpenter know about fishing? I wonder if he thought, "Well, I'm exhausted, and the last thing I want to do is have to climb back into the boat, throw out the nets again, and then bring them all back in and clean them once more." Or I wonder if he thought, "I really just want to quit and go home." Peter does object a little bit, telling Jesus, "We've worked all night and we've caught nothing." But then he adds that little contingency, "But if you say so, we'll try it." And then came the amazing catch of fish that nearly swamped not one but two boats. And the glory of God was revealed to them in Jesus Christ in such a way. It dawned on Peter and the others, and honestly, it scared Peter to the very core of his being. Because all Peter could see in the light of Jesus' presence was his own unworthiness, his own sinfulness, his own humanity. Luke says it this way, "When Simon Peter saw it," that is, the amazing catch of fish, "he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, 'Go away from me, Lord, for I'm a sinful man.' For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish they'd taken." Over and over in the Bible, we see people who are being called by God for service, trying to get away from God or push God away from them, trying to find some way of explaining to God why God shouldn't expect too much out of them, trying to keep God from changing their lives. "Not me, Lord. Surely not me. Away from me, Lord." Simon Peter is one perfect example. Luke shows us how Peter came in direct contact with God through this amazing fishing encounter with Jesus in his boat, up close and personal. And it just scared the daylights out of him. He put up his defenses. He attempted to hide behind his own shame and guilt and saying, "Get away from me, Lord. Not because I don't want to be near you, but I'm just not worthy. You surely don't know who you're dealing with." I'd speculate that many of us have attempted to hide from God's calling, sometimes behind our shame or guilt or our imperfection. We may not even realize that we're doing it. We just have sort of a knee-jerk reaction when we sense that God might be calling us to some special service, that we would say, "Not me, Lord. You've got the wrong person." Maybe we're hiding from having to admit to ourselves and to God that we are capable of growing, of stretching, of changing, and becoming so much more than we are right now. as we allow our lives to become an instrument of change in the hands of Jesus Christ. Too often we allow our past experiences in life to define our present and our sense of what our future potential is. We say, how could God use someone who came from where I've come from? How could God use someone who's made the mistakes that I've made with my life? How could God use someone who is so stuck in the midst of their own pain that they can't see out of their own situation? Well, the great news of the Bible is that God is not a God who chooses and uses only the holiest of holy people to accomplish God's plans, or those who are perfect in their practice of the faith. Instead of calling out Peter's fear, shame, or unbelief, as Peter pushed back, Jesus simply responds, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be catching people." Instead of focusing on Peter's pride or lack of trust, Jesus highlights the continual call to keep on fishing, even when the results, great or small, are a mystery to us. For Peter, James, and John also, the change of life that began that day with Jesus in their boat was profound. So have you ever sensed a call of God in your life that just kept lingering in the background? You weren't quite sure what it was, but you just kept pushing back, saying, "Surely not me." Allowing your own sin or shame of your humanity in light of God's glory and Jesus' amazing power to block your ability to respond openly to the call of God in your life. Like Peter, our humanity shouts, "Not me, Lord, surely not me. Away from me, Lord. There's got to be better qualified people." I'm very familiar with these blocking strategies. I've tried some of them in my own life. What I found was, the more I debated and discussed with God, I was just painting myself into a corner where I had nowhere to go, and ultimately said, "Yeah, you for me, as you are." Well, on those terms, I had nowhere to go. Friends, God uses you and me with our flaws, with our inadequacies, our doubts, and our fears. And the thing is, we're not fooling anybody. Jesus already knows us completely. He loves us fully, and he calls us to claim fully who we are and to follow him, warts, doubts, fear, and all. As a congregation, perhaps we feel weariness and frustration at times because we too feel like, well, we've fished and fished and fished in this neighborhood, and we've not caught many fish over the past 10 years of fishing together. And yet, even amidst pandemic times, new members have come, visitors are coming, friends are finding us. And we still hear the voice of Jesus calling us out to deeper waters to try again and again and to be faithful and persistent in fishing while trusting the results of our efforts, the catch, if you will, to Christ. As 2022 unfolds before us, we're called to keep on fishing faithfully for men and women right here in Carolina Forest and Conway and Myrtle Beach and beyond. The question is, are we willing to fish with Jesus? Such fishing ventures require faith, believing that with God with us, anything's possible, that God has given us a family of faith around us to surround and support us and to help us. And God has provided the power of the Holy Spirit, saying, "I will help you rise to the challenge of being who I'm calling you to be and to become as disciples and as a congregation." Friends, I say this is great news for each of us, and I say, how good of God and thanks be to God. Amen. Now I want to invite Marcia Meek and Nancy Thornburg to come forward, and each of you take one of these chairs. As you will affirm your vows for ordination as ruling elders, along with the current ruling elders who have been elected, Barbara Baranko, Myra Burrows, Nanette Kelly, and Kathy Wechter, if you'll come alongside or behind them. You too have been called to active duty and to reaffirm your ordination vows as you come to re-up your service on the session here at Celebration Presbyterian Church. And let me say one other thing. All ruling elders and teaching elders in the Presbyterian Church are invited to participate in what will be a socially distanced, symbolic laying on of hands for Marcia and Nancy as they're ordained. When the time is right, I'll ask you to simply stand where you are and extend your hands toward them. Normally, we would do the laying on of hands, but out of extreme caution, we will do this distanced effort, okay? Okay, Barbara.
We are called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our common calling to be disciples and servants of our servant Lord. Within the community of the church, some now ordains Marcia Meek and Nancy Thornburg to the office of ruling elder and installs them to active service on the session of our church. The session also installs to have been previously ordained as ruling elders, Barbara Baranko, Myra Burrows, Nanette Kelly, and Kathy Wechter. Ordination calls the whole church to renewed commitment and reminds us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ given to each of us in the covenant of baptism.
As the moderator of the celebration session of those to be ordained and installed, I'll ask you to, well, you're seated, and I'm going to ask you to remain there and those standing to remain standing, but to give answer to these questions. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge Him Lord of all and the head of the church, and through Him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you? Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you? Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you? Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you? And will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you? And will you be faithful ruling elders, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
Microphone.
Do we, the members of the church, accept Barbara Barranco, Myra Burrows, Nanette Kelly, Marsha Meek, Nancy Thornburg, and Kathy Wechter as ruling elders chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
We do.
We do.
Do we agree to encourage them to respect their decisions and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church?
We do.
We do.
And I'll ask those of you who are elders or ruling elders, teaching elders in the Presbyterian Church, to please stand where you are and extend your hands towards those to be ordained, Nancy and Marcia. And I'll offer this prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you've called forth leaders to serve you and equip them with your gifts. Among your people Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors and teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. With Moses, the 70 elders bore the burdens of your people, ministering in the power of your Spirit. In the church, elders and pastors served together so that your whole people might be equipped for ministry and built up into the full unity of Christ. For your servants in every age, O God, and for the church of Jesus Christ, we give you all thanks and praise. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Marsha Meek and Nancy Thornburg, that they may be your faithful ruling elders in this church. Give them prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish them in the life of the Holy Spirit, that they may exercise the ministry of discipline with humility and compassion. Guide them with governance on this session and in every court of the church, that they may be servant leaders following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Give them joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for their work of ministry. As a session, make us strong in Christ to live as your people and to show forth your saving love in the world by the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And then this charge, Marsha Meek and Nancy Thornburg, as well as the rest of you, having been previously ordained, you are now elders in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this celebration congregation. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Normally we would extend to you the right hand of fellowship or the right hug of fellowship, but we're going to have to give you one of these symbolic tips of the head and waving of the hand. But God bless us all as we continue forward. Now, we have some certificates for you as well as one of appreciation for Katrina White. If you'll come down, we want to thank you for your service on the session, having faithfully served and now rotated off active duty. We thank you. Don't be so happy, all right? Thank you, thank you. Any words of wisdom for the rest of them?
Oh, me?
Sir, a parting word.
You know, it's a needed call that, you know, helps continue our work here in Carolina for us. It's not easy, but, you know, the bonds you'll create working together over the course of the next couple of years are bonds that will never be broken. And, you know, wish you all the best. I know that we're in good hands for our continued work.
Thank you. And I'm going to squeeze in and ask Cecilia if she'll take a group shot of us. She's good about helping us get pictures on our Facebook page. Everybody smile behind your mask. Thank you. All right, you may return to your seats. And I'll invite the rest of us to stand.
as you are able, and join us in singing our closing hymn, which I know is Here I Am, Lord, number 69. Seated for just a few reminders and through our postlude. I want to thank you all for your service and support of Celebration Presbyterian Church through your prayers, your participation, your generosity. All of these make all the difference in keeping our church alive and growing. I remind you of our annual congregational meeting next Sunday at the close of worship, reminding you that all members may vote. Tuesday evening Vespers is at 7:30 p.m. Choir is Wednesdays at 6. And we invite you to invite your friends to join us for worship each Sunday at 11 a.m. Whether they come in person or join us through Facebook Live, we would welcome them. Now hear this charge that comes from a book, Our Deepest Fear, by Marion Williamson. Oh, it's actually called A Return to Love, Reflections on the Principles of the Course in Miracles. She says, our deepest fear is not that we're inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we're powerful beyond measure. It's our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, or fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You're a child of God. Your playing small does not serve this world. There's nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine, as God's children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in every one of us. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. And as we're liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others. Now, hear God's call and live your life saying, here am I, send me. Now go out with Jesus and fish, each one, reach one if you can, and watch God reel them in. Now go forth into the world with compassion and justice in your heart. Give voice to the silent and strength to the weak. Hear one another, see one another, care for one another, and love one another. It's all that easy. And it's all that hard. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the powerful presence of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. That have just accepted responsibility. And please extend your kind words to them on your way out. Thank you much. God bless you.